In this lecture, we're going to talk about zero-day vulnerabilities. And zero-day vulnerabilities are the ones that are not known by the general public and has not been discovered at large. We've talked about these before. Those were the ones where if we use intrusion detection or prevention systems or antivirus, since this has never been seen before, we're not going to have a signature for it. And at best, if we are lucky, the heuristic engine, the behavioral one, can pick up on the zero-day attack. But since this is day one, the first time we ever see this attack, it is considered day zero, hence the name. And once the vulnerability is discovered, it is public knowledge. In most cases here, patches and signatures will be released within a short time span. And there are arguably a ton of vulnerabilities out there that at some point will be discovered, but for now are not. When we design our software, they can have millions and millions of lines of code. And even if we do a thorough check on all that code to make sure there are no vulnerabilities, we still assume that at least 1% of that code has errors in it. Now, an error does not mean a vulnerability, but some of those errors will be vulnerabilities. So of course, as soon as the vulnerability is discovered, hopefully the vendor makes a patch for it. We then apply that patch as soon as that patch is considered secure and we have done the proper testing. The worse the vulnerability is, the sooner we need to apply the patch. Let's pretend we're getting attacked and the attacker is using a zero-day vulnerability. We make it lucky that part of our layered defense, our intrusion prevention or intrusion detection, sees this using the behavioral-based engine. But while it is possible, it is also unlikely. And that's why we need those complementary, overlapping layers of security that gives us the defense in depth that we want. And for zero-day, there are a couple of terms I think you need to understand and know the difference between. The zero-day vulnerability is the vulnerability itself. That is the flaw in the software. A zero-day exploit is the code using that vulnerability, and then a zero-day attack is the actual attack using the code. I hope that makes sense. So let's look at a practical example. The Stuxnet worm was a worm that was targeting Iran's nuclear centrifuges. It used 4 unique zero-day exploits, which at the time was something we had never seen before. Most attacks used none. Some rare attacks used 1 zero-day exploit, and here they're using 4. And by now we know it was developed by US and Israel. And it took them close to 5 years to develop. And we estimate the cost to be in the hundreds of millions of dollars. The Stuxnet worm would have 3 separate components. A worm that does what worms do. It propagates aggressively throughout our systems. Then it had a link that would automatically execute the propagated copies of the worm. And then it had a rootkit that would hide itself, hide all the malicious files and the processes, preventing the detection of Stuxnet. The worm itself would spread as much as it could, and it would then scan for Siemens STEP 7 software on any computer it infected. And that computer also had to control a PLC. Now, if both of those conditions were not met, the Stuxnet would become dormant within inside that computer, but it would still replicate. And a PLC is a programmable logic controller. And they're industrial computers that are used for manufacturing, plants, windmills, or other automated environments. It is believed that at some point Stuxnet had infected hundreds of millions of devices, but since it was so specifically designed to look for Siemens STEP 7 PLCs, which is what was used for the Iranian centrifuges, on pretty much all of those hundreds of millions of systems, the worm would just be there, it would propagate, but it wouldn't do anything to that specific system. And once the worm found that very specific target, Siemens STEP 7 PLCs, then and only then, would Stuxnet introduce the infected rootkit into the software. And it wouldn't really do a lot. It would just change a few lines of code, just causing the centrifuges to spin slightly faster, making them break at a higher rate, slowing down the nuclear program. So if you remember back to when we talked about the CIA triad, this is one of those cases where integrity is much, much more important than confidentiality. The US and Israel were completely aware of what Iran was doing. They had all the code, and since they had all the code, they understood exactly what it did. And that's why they could design the Stuxnet worm so specific. All they wanted to do was to change the integrity a tiny bit. Not enough to raise any red flags, but enough to break stuff at a much higher rate. And the Iranians had done what they should in a secure environment like this. They had air-gapped the systems running the centrifuges, meaning there is no connectivity to anything on the outside. But here again, it's the human element that compromises our security. We're pretty sure that the worm was introduced by an engineer that did something that he shouldn't. The engineer's home PC was infected by the Stuxnet worm, and he brought a USB stick to work, and even though the facility is completely segmented from the outside, no internet connection, when he plugged in that USB drive that was infected from his own computer, he introduced the Stuxnet worm where it was intended to go. And this is another good reminder why we would want to lock our USB ports down, but it is even more a good example of why we give our employees the right training, we raise their awareness, we change their behavior. Because if that specific employee had gotten the right training, they had changed their behavior, the systems might never have been infected. And this story is a little bit unique. First off, because of how many zero-day exploits was used. Secondly, because of how specifically it was targeting just those systems. But really, it just is business as usual. More than 120 countries in the world have designed or are designing ways to use the internet as a weapon. Some of them do it to protect themselves, some of them do it to attack others. And with most, it's probably a little bit of both. Alright, let's do a quick recap. We talked about zero-day vulnerabilities. Those are the actual vulnerabilities that have not been widely discovered and published. Then using that vulnerability, the attacker would make a zero-day exploit. That is the code using the vulnerability, and the attacker would then use that code in a zero-day attack. Since this is the first time we see this attack, we don't have any signatures in our antivirus, IDS, or IPS. We can get lucky that the behavioral engine catches it, the heuristic system, but there are no guarantees at all. I would even say it's unlikely. And then we talked a little bit about a worm that used 4 zero-day exploits, the Stuxnet worm. It had the worm that would propagate throughout the systems, then it had a link that would automatically execute the propagated copies of the worm, and then it had a rootkit that would only activate whenever very specific conditions were met. It had to be Siemens STEP 7 PLCs. And the worm was successful. Even though it infected hundreds of millions of devices, it only wanted to get to that one specific device that was controlling the Iranian nuclear centrifuges. The facility was air-gapped like it should be, but an engineer brought it in on a USB stick. We locked down USB ports, we changed our users' behavior so they don't do things like that. I hope this has helped you get a little bit of a better understanding of zero-day attacks, what they are, and how we can maybe protect against them. And with that, we are done. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.